In July of 2023, the FDA approved a new immunization for RSV. As a doctor who spent countless nights in the ICU caring for critically ill children with RSV infections, you know, I'm over the moon for any new technology that could alleviate this burden. On the other hand, it's 2024, and so I know that vaccines and immunizations are really polarizing topics, and so my role here isn't really to tell you what choice to make. Thankfully, I'm just making YouTube videos. I'm not actually in a doctor-patient relationship with you or your child. My goal is really just to share what normally happens to children when they get RSV, and what are the risks of things getting worse and bad things happening, and then to share what evidence is there for the RSV immunization as I understand the studies. So I'll jump right into it. So what normally happens when a child's infected with RSV? Well, first, there's a 3 to 6 day incubation period where there's no real symptoms. So the infection is there, but it hasn't manifested just yet. Then there's symptoms, and this is usually upper respiratory tract infection symptoms. So cough, congestion, runny nose. And this happens for, you know, 1 to 3 days. From there, the virus spreads from the upper respiratory tract to the lungs or the bronchioles in the lower respiratory tract. And this is where we get all the symptoms we talked about before, the grunting, head bobbing, retractions, tachypnea or the fast breathing and that type of thing. And then most children go on to recover in days 7 to 10. And I will just note that, you know, the risk of progressing from an upper respiratory tract infection to a lower respiratory tract infection, the data is not perfect, but I'd say, you know, about 40% of kids will go from just having symptoms up here, common cold essentially, and then go to lower respiratory tract involvement. So before getting ready to do this video, I know it's 2024 and there are kind of pro-vaccine camps and anti-vaccine camps. And so I really wanted to hear, you know, what are parents being exposed to? Because as a pediatrician, I certainly get exposed to a lot of information from the AAP, fellow pediatricians, and you know, kind of mainstream research. But I did want to hear, you know, what do the anti-vax podcasts have to say, and what are people being exposed to? And so I'll just say up front that it is really difficult being a parent in 2024, because when I listen to these podcasts that are pro-vaccine or pro-immunization, and then anti-vaccine and anti-immunization, it just has to be really difficult as a parent to navigate that, where both people are speaking with passion and they're referring to medical studies, and they're suggesting that if you do this or don't do that, then the consequences will be really bad for your children. And so what I noticed is that the way both groups talk about the data is really just from one perspective. So I wanted to break this slide up and talk about it from two different perspectives to see if this is helpful. So first, when we talk about RSV in general, it is the cause of 2.1 million outpatient visits per year. So that's an incredible burden of disease. That's a lot of people and children being affected. It's the cause of 50 to 80,000 children being so sick they have to be hospitalized, you know, with RSV. And then when you just look at children who have been hospitalized for respiratory illnesses, it's the cause of about a third of those hospitalizations. And so from that perspective, you know, this is a huge burden for children. On the other hand, you know, I don't want parents to think that, oh, you know, if my child gets RSV, that it's all doom and gloom, because the real, like, individual risks are not super high. So if my child got RSV or your child gets RSV, the risk of progressing to have such a serious infection that you need, or he or she needs hospitalization, it's like 1.5 to 3%. So 97 to 98.5% of the time, your child's gonna be okay and not have to be hospitalized. And then even among children who get hospitalized and they're in the hospital for an RSV infection, only about 2 to 5% of them will need to go to the intensive care unit where I work, or need mechanical ventilation, where you have to put a breathing tube in and use a ventilator to breathe for the child. And then even less likely, there are only about 1 to 300 deaths that are truly related to RSV per year, and they're frequently associated with prematurity or other coexisting medical conditions. So from a 10,000 foot view, this is a horrible thing for children generally. For any individual child who gets RSV, most of the time they will get over it with a mild to moderate illness. So that's one way to look at this, to say what's the burden of disease and what is the likelihood if my child gets RSV that something bad's gonna happen. But I will say there's another interesting aspect that I just wanna point out, and this isn't fully defined, but I think it's an important thing to think about. There is essentially a threefold increase in the development of asthma among children who have, you know, moderate bronchiolitis, and especially that caused by RSV. So we don't know, does that moderate or severe infection with RSV and bronchiolitis cause the development of asthma down the road? Or is it that children who are predisposed to developing asthma are also the children who are more likely to have a moderate or severe infection with RSV bronchiolitis? So we don't know if it's causal, but it's just another thing to note that there is this association between bronchiolitis and then developing asthma later on. Okay, so what's the whole purpose of, what are we talking about? Well, there is a new monoclonal antibody. It's an immunization, not a vaccine, called Beyfortus or Nirsevimab that is available for essentially all children and now being recommended by the CDC and the AAP. So I wanted to talk about it a little bit. First and foremost, people have made this point. I think it's really important that this is not a vaccine in the truest sense. It's really an immunization. And so what's the difference here? Well, in general, when you have a vaccine, like on the left side of the screen here, you essentially take dead virus particles or pieces of bacteria, pieces of viruses, and inject them into a person. The person's immune system then kind of gets revved up and reacts to whatever got injected to make antibodies to defend the next time that it encounters that virus or bacteria in the real world. Okay, and so that's usual vaccines, and that's called active immunity, where you have the immune system revved up. But there's also something called passive immunity, and that's what Beyfortus or Nirsevimab is. And this is where you actually just say, okay, we're just gonna give you the antibodies so that if RSV infects you while you have these antibodies around, then they'll bind them, your immune system will recognize them, and you won't have a severe infection. So in this case, it never actually revs up the immune system. So I'll say that's a critical thing to note up front, that when the baby gets these antibodies, they are just kind of there for a couple months hanging around in case an RSV infection gets into the baby's body. They can bind to the RSV, the baby can fight it off before developing all of these symptoms. But it's not actually the baby's immune system that's getting fired up or generating this this host response. Okay, so let's look at the two big studies that the FDA really looked at to make the decision to approve this in the United States, and then has driven, you know, the AAP and CDC recommendations. So the first one, it's the smaller of the two studies. It was basically 1,500 infants, and they did a randomized and blinded study. So essentially, they took infants, and they said you were either gonna get Nirsevimab or you're gonna get an injection of saline, so basically just nothing. Neither group knew whether they were receiving the immunization or just the saline, and then they followed the groups for several months to see who developed what we call medically attended RSV infections. And this basically just means the baby got RSV and it was bad enough that the parent took the child to a healthcare provider. So it could be an outpatient visit, the ER, or otherwise. So you can see the main results here, that among the children who received the placebo, so they just got saline and didn't get the immunization, there was about a 5% risk that an infant in that group would have to present to a medical provider for an RSV infection. For the group that received Nirsevimab, that rate was 1.2%. So the efficacy here means there was a 75% reduction in the number of patients who had medically attended or severe enough to go to the doctor RSV infection. Always important to say, so that's kind of the benefit that they found. Well, what were the adverse events? So the rate of adverse events was the same in both groups, serious adverse events. And so in general, what that means is that there wasn't any sign that Nirsevimab was causing any more adverse events than saline. So essentially, there wasn't anything really to worry about. Now, I will say, in the paper, I looked and there were 3 deaths reported, and all of them occurred in the Nirsevimab group. For what it's worth, when there are adverse events related to monoclonal antibodies in these injections, they tend to happen early. Each of these deaths occurred more than 3 months after receiving the injection, and none of them seem to be associated with the injection itself. 2 of them were related to really bad gastroenteritis or a stomach bug, and the 3rd was thought to be related to an undiagnosed chronic medical condition after reviewing the patient's chart. So how should you interpret this? Well, overall, the way I interpret it is, it's something to note that there were 3 deaths, but none of them, when I look at it and I actually look through the appendices and the supplementary material, there's nothing that indicates that they were related to the immunization itself. Okay, and then there was a 2nd paper, came out about a year later in 2023, and this was 8,000 infants, so it was more than previously. And here they got randomized to either getting the injection or not getting anything. So in this case, it wasn't a placebo that got injected. They just didn't receive any shot. And they were looking at Nirsevimab versus not getting a shot. And the endpoint was a little different. They wanted to see how frequently did infants develop an RSV infection that was so severe they had to go to the hospital. So in this case, you can see on the right side, the standard care, there were 4,000 infants. Out of those 4,000, 60 had to be hospitalized, so 1.5%. On the left side is the patients who received the immunization, Nirsevimab. Out of those 4,000, only 11 patients had to be hospitalized. So it was an 83% reduction in the risk of hospitalization from RSV infection by receiving the immunization. Here, the adverse events numerically were pretty similar for any adverse events, but I tend not to care about this as much. It's really the serious adverse events that I pay more attention to. And in this case, there was only a single infant out of the 4,000 that had a serious adverse event that they thought could have been related to the immunization. It was an infant who developed infantile spasms or a type of epilepsy, and it happened 3 to 4 weeks after receiving the injection. The authors know that there was no reason to think that the injection actually caused it, but because of the time course, they had to characterize it as could be related to the injection. The other thing the authors note is that about 1 in 8,000 children will develop West syndrome over the period that they were looking at the infants. And so most likely this would have occurred whether the child received the injection or not. So a summary of the trials, the reduction in the risk of having an RSV infection so bad that you have to go to the doctor goes from 5% down to 1.2%. And then the risk of having an RSV infection so bad you have to be hospitalized goes from 1.5% down to 0.3%. And then overall, you know, I tried to be as honest as I could about how they reported the data with the adverse events, but it really was, you know, out of the, I guess, probably like 9,500 patients total, similar adverse events in each category, which essentially means that there weren't serious adverse events that likely were caused by the immunization. So where does that leave us? So the CDC has now recommended that all infants under 8 months of age should receive a dose of Nirsevimab prior to that first bronchiolitis season, unless the mom has received that Pfizer vaccine, which is called Abrysvo, during pregnancy. And then if you're a high-risk patient from 8 months old to 19 months old, but you have things like prematurity, immunocompromise, or chronic medical conditions, then you should also receive the Nirsevimab again for the RSV season. So just to be clear, I'm not an OBGYN, but I did want to comment just quickly on the Abrysvo. So this is a true vaccine that can be given to a woman in pregnancy. And so the vaccine is given, the mom's immune system generates antibodies, and then those antibodies are passed on to the infant through the placenta. So the infant is born immunized or with resistance to RSV. And this actually has been studied, you know, even probably better than the Nirsevimab. There have been 6 different studies, 18,000 pregnant women in total, and they essentially showed that the hospitalization rate for infants was cut in half from 2.2 down to 1.1%. So the number is a little bit different from what we looked at, but still a sort of similar efficacy. And so overall, you know, I think that either one would be reasonable, doing Nirsevimab for an infant or Abrysvo, if that was the couple's preference. Again, like I said at the beginning, the way you look at the data is important and how you feel about it, whether your child should get an immunization or not. And so I'll kind of review it here from both sides. So on the one hand, you know, there's a 75% reduction in RSV infections requiring a doctor's visit. And that means that it could prevent 1.6 million RSV visits per year. So that's huge. And kind of speaks for itself. On the other hand, your risk, if a child in front of me has RSV, the risk that they're going to require a doctor's visit or it's gonna be that severe is only 5% at baseline, but this goes down to 1% if they get the immunization. Similarly, there's an 83% reduction in the RSV infections that would require hospitalization. 13,600 infants per year could avoid getting admitted to the hospital, and that's huge to me. But again, for an infant in front of me, if they have an RSV infection, the likelihood they're actually gonna end up in the hospital is only like 1.5% from the studies we looked at, but it drops down to 0.3% if they receive the immunization. And then with all the caveats I talked about and try to be as transparent as I could with the studies themselves, from my perspective, there's no real evidence of increased adverse events. And so I think these immunizations are safe to be given. I will say all these studies were funded by pharmaceutical companies, but I wanna qualify a bit about what that means. What that really means is that the companies paid for the cost of doing the trial. So these trials are incredibly expensive and difficult to execute. You need many research coordinators, statisticians, clinicians, and then of course principal investigators to dedicate time to make it happen. A critical thing to note is that the principal investigator and the study staff, they won't make more money based on the results of the study. So they are not, in my opinion, really in pharma's back pocket or incentivized in a real way to fudge results or anything like that. So from my perspective, this is an important thing to be aware of, but in no way does it disqualify the results. And moreover, with big studies like this, there are always independent data monitoring groups that have to watch the studies to make sure that people aren't fudging the numbers numbers, and then they're coming in and giving accurate results. So overall, my recommendation, of course, would be to get the immunization. I think when I look at these, you know, results, it would just be a staggering benefit to children. I joke, but I truly feel like this could have a negative impact on my job security as an intensive care unit doctor, and that's a great thing. I hope that this puts me out of business. I would love it if children stopped coming to the ICU with RSV infections, and I really think if there was large uptake of this immunization, that type of thing would happen. I mean, an 83% reduction in hospitalizations is unbelievable. So that's certainly my perspective on it, but whatever side of the fence you kind of sit on, I hope this was helpful for you. And again, it's just kind of one person's opinion and how I looked at the study. So I hope you enjoyed it. I actually don't know what the next video is going to be about, but you know, at some point when I post this, hopefully I'll have it linked up here or something. So click on that as well. All right. Thanks so much and take care.